कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे. So since this is the last session, I'm going to do it. I'm not going to proceed further. There are totally 8 questions and answers in the form of PPTs. We may not be able to cover all of them. And another time when I come, I will continue it. But it is very important for us, whenever we learn anything, to assimilate and have some call for action in our lives personally. So the next probably around half an hour, I will devote time for this. And then another 10 minutes, I can take some questions, I think. 8:40 I can close the session. What we have done till now, yesterday and today, the first question was about material desires. We're discussing about how to deal with material desires. So we devoted time in understanding about abhyasa and vairagya, practice and detachment. And we also learnt about enthusiasm and austerity. So these terms are generally used, but we used many little examples to understand how these things can greatly help us in keeping our spiritual life very focused and concentrated and intense. So therefore we devote a time for that. Our material desires, we need not fear them. We can substitute them with spiritual desires. Then second question, we discussed about distraction. So I was telling you in the morning about how that the distractions carry us away from our goal. In the case of Bharat Maharaj, the deer was the distraction. In our case, it could be a smartphone, it could be some video games, it could be TV, it could be internet surfing, it could be our busy material activities. Or even while chanting in the morning, so many thoughts of the past and fear of the future come in the mind. They are also very powerful distractors. So, although the process of devotional service is very easy, nevertheless, there is one condition the Lord has put, that we should perform the chanting with attention. That's considered very important. Without attention, we will not be able to gain focus and concentration. Just like imagine you take a magnifying glass in your hand and you keep a paper below and you keep shaking it like this. Can you burn the paper or cotton if you shake it like this? Similarly, a disturbed mind cannot get focus. The agitated mind cannot get focus. So then why is mind agitated? Mainly because of the virus in the mind, which is called material desires. Another reason why the mind is shaking is because of the dualities, we call it. The dualities are, 6 are explained in the Bhagavad Gita. He says, Jitātmana prashantātmā paramātmā samāhitaha śītoṣṇa sukha dukkeṣu tatā mānā pamāna yoho. Śītoṣṇa means summer and winter. Or the deeper meaning of summer and winter is, there are certain things not satisfactory to you in your life. Say today's food was not very attractive, for example. Or your transport was not very comfortable. Or your comfort level in the office is not good in your room or something. So these are also considered as summer winter. Which means actually some deficiencies in your life, material deficiencies in your life, they become too important to you and you keep talking about it. Then your time gets wasted in that. You get distracted. Like there are many people who keep talking about the idiosyncrasies of their other family members. Like husband can blame about wife and wife can blame the husband. Or both of them together can blame the children, or children can blame the parents. Or a lady can tell the glories of her family, husband will tell glories of his family to husband and wife. But when they go to their respective family, they will fight there also. You will see that. So you will see these are all Shita-Ushna. Shita-Ushna means what? Talking about the comforts and discomforts, conveniences and inconveniences, you know, difficulties and troubles, and pleasures and pains. So in this way, Shita-Ushna, Sukha-Dukha, Man-Apaman means honor and dishonor. Jada-Bharat In the later part, you all will read, he underwent all six of them. Shita Ushna means what? He was given burnt rice to eat. He didn't comment about it. He just ate it. He was asked to become a scarecrow in the field and neglected. He didn't mind it. He accepted it. They ill-treated him, his brothers. They didn't give him comforts at home. They didn't give him the share of property. He didn't care. Later, Jadabharata was given sukha dukkha, you know, pleasure pain. When he was taken by those dacoits to a Kali Mata's temple, where they first bathed him, dressed him with silken clothes, put chandan, kumkum and garland and everything, gave him a big plate of food also to eat. So that is all pleasure. And then they took a knife to cut his neck. That is pain. So he was given both pleasure and pain also. Sukha dukkha was given to him. Thirdly, he encountered one king called Rahugana, who was traveling on a palanquin. And men who were carrying the palanquin were finding it difficult, so they wanted somebody stronger, and they caught hold of this fellow, Jadabharata, and he had to lift the palanquin. While lifting it, he saw the ants on the way. He didn't want to put his foot on them, so he walked in a zigzag way, and the king got wild. He shouted. It's a long pastime cut short, but I can tell you he was given apaman by the king. The king sarcastically criticized him very strongly. He told him, he looked outside and saw that this fellow was a strong fellow. So he said, oh, my dear thin man, you are carrying me for a very long time. And that too, you are carrying all alone with nobody else to help you. Like that, king spoke very sarcastically. See, if somebody speaks to you sarcastically, it's very painful, isn't it? Jadabharata knows very well, I'm not carrying alone. Three more fellows are there with me, carrying palanquin. And I'm not carrying long distance. I just now picked it up. And I'm not very thin. My body is pretty fat. And the king is sarcastically calling me. See, more than straightforward speech is sarcastic speech, very painful. Like one time I saw one fellow came to the prasadam hall. He saw there was only this much, you know, lady's finger, bendi sabji was available this much in the bucket. But he made the bucket like this and put on the plate everything. And then he took the rice and everything and he started eating. So another fellow was coming in. So he saw this fellow doing like this. And then he asked, Prabhu, I heard that there was half a bucket bendi. You know, you ate all of it? He asked him. So that fellow said, no, half was not there, full was there. Full bucket I ate, he said. So who was sarcastic? Out of the two? First one or second one? The answer is both. Yeah. You will see, that fellow asked, there was half a bucket bendi, you ate all of it, he asked. This fellow said, there was one bucket. So who was sarcastic? Both. So why they are sarcastically speaking? Because sarcastic speech pierces a person's heart. It's man apaman. People, therefore you will find in families also sometimes people talk about your family and my family. You know, there is Dwarkadish Prabhu and his good wife Vishakha Mataji. Vishakha Mataji was telling in one meeting and she came to Pune. She said, whenever ladies' family members come from anywhere, so the wife is very enthusiastic. She makes everything, all arrangements, goes with them to market, purchases this, purchases that, does everything. She puts her sweat and toil, everything, 3-4 days when they are there. And then another time when husband's family members come. And she says, I am feeling little headache, you know, can you do it or something like that. You know? See, this is not my example. I told you whose example? This is whose example? Vishakha Mataji, you can check with her if you want. Mataji was quoting. She was telling, the husband sometimes argues with the wife, why only you get headache only when my family members come? And then she was telling, for her lady, her mother-in-law should become mother-in-law. Father-in-law should become father-in-law. There should be no more law. Law should become love. Then they can give their heart and rendering service, she was telling. So, in this world you find that we have a tendency to insult others, or when we are insulted we feel pain, man apaman. See, Jadabharata was insulted by Rahugana very badly, sarcastically. But later when Jadabharata spoke words of wisdom, you know, Rahugana jumped down and caught hold of the feet of Jadabharata and cried tears and said, I am sorry. Naham vishanke sura raja bajra natraksha shula nayamasya dandat. So he goes on to say, I am not afraid of Yama's danda, I am not afraid of Varuna's pash, I am not afraid of Indra's thunderbolt, but Shanke Brisham Brahma Kulavamana. He says, I am afraid of Vaishnava Prad. He says, so please forgive me. I didn't know you are a great soul. Like that, he catches hold of his feet. That means now he gave man now. He did apaman in the top. Now after coming down, he gave man. So he got Shita Ushna, Sukha Dukha, man apaman. But in all these six situations, Jadabharat's mind was very stable. And that's what we all have to practice also. Please repeat this statement from Krishna book. Prabhupada writes this. One's greatness has to be estimated by one's ability to tolerate provoking situations. So, who is great devotee, who is not so great devotee will be estimated by how we tolerate provoking situations in our life. And it's not that for no rhyme or reason we are tolerating. There is a reason. Imagine, for example, you are in a theater or somewhere hall. You know, the center of the hall, there is a hole in the top. And there's a ladder lying in the corner. Now, suddenly there is a fire breakout from all the four sides of the hall. When you go to some theater or somewhere. So you can take the ladder and put it. And if you climb out, you can escape from the top. Otherwise, all the four sides, there is fire. Now you got the ladder, you put it, you want to climb up now. Imagine at that time, some people are ridiculing you around you. Or some people are insulting you. Now you have two choices now. Either to get down from the staircase and whoever was ridiculing you, catch them by the collar and slap them. Or somebody was insulting you, you give reply to them that you are misunderstanding me, you don't understand, you argue with them. Or you can climb up and go out. So how many of you feel that we should not leave anybody who is ridiculing us or yelling at us? We have to take action. How many of you feel? Anybody feels that? Because for you, which one is important? Going out is important, or proving that you are right is important? Escaping is important. It's a recent news. 2-3 months ago, there was one plane which had become extremely heated up. So they landed somewhere. And immediately announcement was made that the emergency door is open. All of you should immediately get out. Because any time the plane is going to explode because the heat level has increased a lot or something. So one fellow, somehow he was blocking the way and taking out his bag. He thought, I will go with my bag. Because of him, 40 people died. Because he was blocking the way, he wanted to take the bag. He didn't immediately get down. Because of that, 30 to 40 people passed away because of that. So why I am saying, because for this fellow, baggage was more important. Not the life of himself and others. You see? Because of attachment, correct, no? He thought, anyway, we are going to run out, I'll take the bag and go. But opening the thing and taking out, and it was not coming out, he was pulling out, time got lost and the plane exploded. So many people died. So we have to ask, this is samsara dhavanala in which I am staying. The whole world is on fire. There are different type of problems. Do I want to go back to Godhead? Or I want to prove to others that I am right, you are wrong? The choice is ours. Jadabharata preferred which one? First time, going back to Godhead. Therefore he was mild. He understood that there's no point. In this world, he knows very well, everybody is in a proving mode. Nobody is in an improving mode. Nobody wants to improve. Everybody wants to prove, I am right, you are wrong. And the other fellow says the same thing, I am right, you are wrong. There's no end to this. But if you are really keen that you want to go back to Godhead, we should have a spiritual focus. Then mind becomes very calm. You read 1.1.2 Bhagavatam, Prabhupada says that in the purport, that those who are aiming at the spiritual world, they are not envious of other living entities. They don't compete with other living entities. Because spiritual world is a competitionless place. So, for those who are aiming at spiritual world, in fact, even Indra is very happy if you aim at the spiritual world. Like Parikshit Maharaj is hearing Bhagavatam and going back to Godhead. On the last day, 7th day, Indra is showering flowers. If somebody had a material desire in their mind, Indra will be very worried. Maybe this fellow will come to heaven and say, ask me to vacate the seat and he will sit there. Isn't it? But if you are a devotee aiming at spiritual world, then Indra will shower flowers on you. You have no enemies. You go back to Godhead. So, please repeat this verse. Na krodho na cha matsaryo na lobho na shubha matihi bhavanti krita punyanam Bhaktanam Purushottame. The Purushottama Bhaktas means the Lord's devotees. He says that they are very, very busy in Bhavanti Krita Punyanam. They are accumulating Bhakti Sukriti only. They are not interested in anything else. He says, Nakrodo, they don't unnecessarily become angry. Nakrodo, Nacha Matsaryo, they are never unnecessarily. Matsarata means what? Para Utkarsha Asahanam. Sridhar Swami in his commentary says, Para Utkarsha Asahanam means not tolerating others' progress. That is Matsarata. Nakrodo, Nacha Matsaryo, Na Lobho. Lobha means unhealthy comparisons and greed and all that. Na ashubha matihi means malice towards others. That means revengeful attitude or bad wishes for others. So actually Vaishnava is free from all this. He's saying na krodho na chamatsari na lobho na ashubha matihi bhavanti krita punyana bhaktanam purushottame. Devotees are completely focused and concentrated and absorbed in performing Krishna conscious devotional activities. And they don't get diverted, distracted by all this Shitavishna, Sukaduka, Mana, Pamana, all that. And Jadabharata is our role model for that. Take Bharat Maharaj, take Jadabharat. They were just the opposite. Bharat got distracted and Jadabharat was focused. Bharat Maharaj was careless while dealing with the deer, fondling with it playing with it. But Jadabharat was extremely alert not to get distracted by anything else. So therefore, Bharat learnt a lesson subsequently. Now one more very important point. So today morning we discussed about the distraction. So I told you all these things just now to say that if we really want to go back to Godhead, we should be very focused. And for those who are focused in spiritual life, their life can be very, very simple. Actually, when we take this Shita Vishnu Sukha Dukha Manapaman too seriously, then only our life becomes very complicated. Like for example, somebody thinks, what will the people in society think of me if I don't have a bigger car? My friend is in the similar post in the company. He has such a big car, I have a smaller car. So many people worry about what others will think of me in the society. So this is one of the reasons for most of the people in this world is suffering, because the mind always keeps making unhealthy comparisons and expectations, unrealistic expectations. So now, in the morning I told you about mental hunger towards the end. I told crack jack biscuit and all that example I was giving. So now, one very important slide which we could not touch, I will touch now, that one. Prabhu, I'll tell you the slide number, you can open that. Okay, you can go to 14, slide number 14. So, how to avoid fall down and intensify our Krishna consciousness, we will see a little bit of that. And then something very valuable concluding point will come. You got it? Yeah, that is the one. How to avoid fall down and intensify. Now go to the next one. So Prabhupada is saying, be cautious, don't neglect. Neglecting rules and regulations and chanting Hare Krishna will cause fall down. Rise early in the morning, bathe, attend Mangalarti, worship the deities, chant Hare Krishna, study Vedic literatures and follow all rules prescribed by Acharyas and Guru. Thanks to Prabhupada, he made our life pretty simple. The things which he emphasizes in his books are very, very, easy and simple, and he repeats it in many places, because in Kali Yuga we tend to forget things. So Prabhupada keeps reminding us. So next one, next slide, Prabhu. So I have shown one by one, we'll go. Yeah, first one chanting, yeah. One more? Yeah, that much, yeah. So let us go one by one. In chanting, I have mentioned about chanting. What happens when we chant Hare Krishna? It destroys our material desires. It gives us determination. And it awakens the sleeping soul. Prabhupada told the story. Once Mr. John was sleeping in one building. In the next building, another man was living, and both their windows were open. So this man was just looking at John's place. So he saw that a thief had somehow broken into John's room. And the thief was taking a sharp knife. So he was thinking of, killing John and stealing his wallet. So when the thief was lifting the knife, this fellow shouted from here, Mr. John, Thief has broken! Like that he shouted. And immediately John jumped up from his bed and thief also jumped up and ran away. And John's life was saved. So Prabhupada says this little story, and then he says that imagine when John is sleeping, which sense is most active, he's asking. For example, in a paper you write, a thief has come, take care. If you show it, will he be able to see? He is sleeping. Is it not true? And even if you touch his body also, if you touch and say, thief has come, he will turn around and go to sleep. But here is the sense which is most alert. Therefore, we have alarm clock. It makes a sound, no? Get up, isn't it? So alarm clock makes a bigger and bigger sound. Why? To wake us up. Because sound can wake up a sleeping person. Similarly, spiritual sound can wake up a sleeping soul. Material sound can wake up a sleeping person, but spiritual sound can wake up a sleeping soul. Therefore, when we chant and try to hear, again chant and try to hear, gradually the soul starts, you know, rubbing his eyes and getting up and opening his hands and legs, and he starts rendering devotion service. Just think about your own spiritual life. Many years ago when you came to the temple, you didn't even understand what is the philosophy, what this ISKCON stands for, many things we didn't know. But we have only, the good thing about us is we have been coming regularly. If you have been coming regularly, taking darshan and keep doing devotional service, gradually we start waking up to understand the philosophy. We become more and more evolved, more and more advanced, more and more clarity comes. So therefore, the chanting wakes up the sleeping soul and also it destroys material desires. What is the proof? The proof is Dhruva Maharaj. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. He kept chanting for 6 months. And the result is what? 6 months before, he wanted to have a kingdom bigger than not his father. But his great-grandfather is Brahma. See, his father is Uttanapad. Uttanapad's father is Swayambhumanu. Swayambhumanu's father is Brahma. And he wanted a kingdom better than Brahma Satyaloka also. He wanted. Therefore, Lord created which loka for him? Dhruva Loka. But after meeting Vishnu, what he said? He said, thank you for the Dhruva Loka, he told. What he said? He said, Kacham Chinvan Apidivya Ratnam Swamin Kritartho Asmi Varamne Acha. He said, oh Lord, after getting you, why will I want a Dhruva Loka? I don't want it now. I am ashamed for asking for it. Like that he said. It's like going to the richest man in the world and asking for $1 or $0.01. I have met the biggest personality. Now I don't need anything. I am completely satisfied. That means Dhruva Maharaj had a desire and the desire went away. Just like one boy was telling, before going by aeroplane, he had a great desire that I want to fly in a plane. He thought it's a status symbol, you know, to fly in a plane. And he wasn't very rich. But then when he got a job, when he got rich, he flew in a plane. But after going in a plane a few times, you get bored. It's like bus only. It's not nothing special. You know, nowadays you go to the airport, there's such a long queue of people. You know, it's like bus stand only now. And many companies are on duty sending so many people now. So the charm goes away over a period of time. That means it's not that your desires remain. Desires, like you were all children, you were attracted to balloon or a tricycle. Now how many of you are attracted to balloon? But you see the small children, when a balloon person sees in India, he makes a sound, tr 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 like that. And children will go mad. I want that balloon. And parents say, why do you want a balloon? You know, it's going to burst. Useless. And instead of that apple balloon, I'll give you real apple. Eat it. And child says, no, I don't want real apple. I want the apple balloon only. You've seen that? But when you grow up, that balloon desire is gone now. That goes away. When the boy becomes a teenage boy, then there's attraction for a teenage girl. You know, there's another type of balloon attraction. You know, you become attract mad. And they go mad actually between 13 to 19. You know, everything appears like I am flying in the sky, she is like a fairy, and we are so many things. Imagine, you know, nightingales are singing, cuckoos are cooing, and flowers are falling from heaven, and so many things. And then when you get married and beget 2 children and admit them in the school, you come to ground level. Correct, no? And then there is one more balloon. What is it? Money, money, money. Money is honey. Correct, no? After that, then money becomes everything. You become obsessed with making money. Then you think, unless I make this much money, then only I'll be happy, peaceful. And then as you grow, you find that no matter how much you earn, it's like putting water in a basket, water keeps going down. You wonder, You know, earlier I was making some money, now I'm making 5 times more. Still it doesn't, you know, it doesn't feel enough. So in this way you will find our desires keep changing in this world, you will see that. But when you come to Krishna consciousness, actually you will see that the material desires gradually go far, far away to the background. And desire to serve Krishna comes more and more into the front. Spiritual desires increase. Like once in our temple, Gauranga Prabhu had come to Pune. So at that time, one announcer was announcing, you know, so-and-so Prabhu distributed 23 books, like that he announced. So that devotee was sitting way behind, he immediately jumped up and went running to that announcer and shook his shoulders and said, "Hey Prabhu, that is not 23, that's 73, he said. Because 73 was written like two kind of thing. So then they announced, anyway, the deities are about to get closed, he said. No. So-and-so Prabhu distributed 73 books, he said. Everybody said, Hari Bol, they said. Then another devotee got very disturbed by this. He came to me and said, "Prabhu, why this devotee is attached to results so much? You know, 23, 73, what difference it makes, Prabhuji? Lord is watching from the altar, he knows what is the score. Whether you tell or not, he knows. Is it not true? Why this person is shaking his shoulder and wanting to change the announcement? I really hate this kind of fruity mentality you are telling." So then I told to Gauranga Prabhu during the day, one devotee felt very disturbed by this fellow's behavior. What do you say? Gauranga Prabhu always is very jovial, very jolly. You know, he said, "See, earlier this boy might have been crazy for cricket scores. Now he is crazy for book scores." You know, he said, and then he said, "Tomorrow he will not be crazy for book scores also. He will become crazy for Krishna only. Later on. Just we have to wait for some more time." The beauty of devotional service is that over a period of time, the material desires go to the background. And spiritual desires awaken more and more. And if we don't chant, we become spiritually weak. And then we deviate or get distracted to material ambitions and material goals. It is a fact actually. To the degree our chanting is weak, our material desires start popping up one by one. New material desires come. You'll be frightened. You may wonder, there are devotees who at the age of 25 to 30 were very serious in spiritual life. Husband, wife, both were fully engaged. But when they became 40, 45, gradually they became weak because of too much material association. And suddenly at 45 they felt, "Hare, we didn't enjoy life enough. Now let us go on a European tour. Let us dress like a 25-year-old person, how they will dress. You dress like that," and all these things. Why? Because the material desires have come up, sprouted up. They thought that one last stroke of enjoyment will take before we turn 50. People think at 45 and they again want to, they miss the honeymoon, now we will go for a tour and enjoy this, enjoy that. Why such desires come that I'm missing something in life? Actually, you are not missing anything, you are only missing suffering when you come to Krishna consciousness. But it is an imagination of the mind that you are missing something. And that happens because of chanting improper, offensive chanting. That's the reason. If anybody is very sincere in chanting, they will be deeply satisfied in the heart. They will have no wants at all. They will say that, you know, "Swamin Kritartho Asmi, Varam Nayache, I am completely satisfied." Prahlad Maharaj was asked by Lord Narasimhadev, "Prahlad, you have done such wonderful devotional service to me. Tell me, what do you want?" And Prahlad became angry. He said, "What? Do you think I am a businessman that I did devotional service to you and then you are going to, you know, give me some benediction? I am not a baniya, I am not a businessman who has come to you." And then Lord Narasimha was surprised. He said, okay, Prahlad, don't become angry. You know, I just like that I asked you. Actually, Lord is angry, Lord, but now Lord had to pacify Prahlad. And then Prahlad said, "Aham tvakamastvad bhaktastvam cha swamyanapashrayah na anyate havayor arto raja sevaka yoriva." My dear Lord, you are a raja, I am a sevak. I simply want to love and serve you. "Yadidasyasi me kaman varam svam varadarshava kamanam hridya samroham bhavatastu vrinevaram." Lord didn't leave him. He insisted, "Still you should ask for something," he told him. Then Prahlad said, "Okay, I will ask you for one thing." You know what he said? "Yadi dasasi me kaman varam svam varadarshava." "You want to give me something? Okay, I will ask you for a boon." He said, "Kamanam hridya samroham." "In my heart, if there are any material desires, now please destroy them," he said. "Because I come in the family of Hiranyakashipu, my body is impure. Because the demoniac blood is flowing in my body. Maybe likely I may have some unknown desires hidden. In case you find them, my Lord, you can see, you have X-ray vision to see. So you destroy those desires also." Lord thought, my Lord, such an intelligent boy. He has tricked me by asking me to destroy any material desire in the heart. He had no material desires at all. This is Prahlad. So that is because Prahlad's heart has become completely purified. That's about chanting. See the regulative principles. What happens when you follow the 64 regulative principles? Now, which are the 64? Beginning with Ado Guru Padashtai, Sadharma Pritcha, Vishramena Guru Seva, Guru Sadhu Vartmanu Vartmanam, Krishna Dikshadi Shikshanam. These are the first five. Ado Guru Padashtai means take shelter of a guru. Sadharma Pritcha means inquire from him religious principles. Vishrambena Guru Seva means serve Guru by following his instructions. Sadhu Atman Vatman means follow in the footsteps of saintly Vaishnavas. And fifth one is Krishna Dikshadi Shikshanam. Take Shiksha and Diksha. Like that, 64 principles are mentioned in Nectar of Devotion. And of which five are prominent. You know that famous verse. Sadhu Sangha Nama Kirtan Bhagavata Shravan Mathura Vasa Shri Murtira Shraddaya Sevan. This is from Chaitanya Charitamrita. He says, Sadhu Sangha means saintly association, Nama Kirtan, chanting of the holy name, Bhagavata Shravan, hearing of Srimad Bhagavatam, and Mathura Vasa means making your home into Vrindavan, and Shri Murtira Shraddaya Sevan, worshipping the deity form of the Lord. These five things are called the five most potent forms of devotional service. So, if we do these things, what will happen to us, he says, we lose our desire for sinful habits. Actually, it is said the grihasthas, for grihasthas, the deity worship is very strongly recommended, Prabhupada says. The reason is this, because a man or a woman, when they associate with each other, there is a very strong attraction for the bodies. And later on, the child comes, and the touching the child, embracing the child, produces a deep sense of material attachment. But when one worships the deity, you pick up the small deity in the hand, you bathe the deity, you feed him madhupak, and then you make yantra and everything, and then you dress him, and you decorate him. So by doing that, just like you developed attachment to your child by doing those things for the child, when you do it for the deities, you develop attachment to the deities. That is the scientific reason for it. So those who do deity worship very faithfully, they will lose in this way all the material desires. So in this way he says that all the 64 regulative principles, accepting Charanamrita, circumambulating the temple, bowing down before the Lord, you know, everything. You can read in Nectar of Devotion. So we lose our desire for sinful habits, he says, by this. Prabhupada says this. Not only you become free from sinful reaction, you lose the taste only for sinful habits. And you develop a taste for spiritual habits. Like Prabhupada and his sister Bhavatarini, when they were small kids, they would go to the Radha Govind temple and watch how the Lord is, Lord Arati is performed, isn't it? Because of that, he developed spiritual desires. Then subsequently, he wanted to do Rathyatra for Krishna, correct, na? For Jagannath, like that. And we gradually develop a firm conviction and bhava for Krishna. Okay, now let us come to study of Prabhupada books. What happens by that? How to study Prabhupada says, discuss the subject minutely, inspect it from all angles. Prabhuji, next one, yeah, go ahead, Prabhu. One more, after that. Inspect it from all angles and savor new understandings. When you study Prabhupada books like that, then we get knowledge and bliss. Not only you get knowledge, you feel enlightenment and enlivenment, both you get. And the result is you become convinced. And then austerities become very easy to perform. You see, for example, imagine you have a plaster on your, what do you call it? Is it plaster or band-aid? Band-aid, I think, in your leg. Next day when you have to remove it, all the hair also comes with that. It's very painful, isn't it? But if you put some water, it comes very smoothly. Similarly, if you read and you get some bliss by reading Prabhupada books, then detachment will become very natural, very easy. It's like putting some water and removing the band-aid. It won't be difficult. So you feel Krishna juice. When you feel Krishna juice, it's very easy to remove. Just like you find, this Goa, when it is ripe, it's yellow in color. You go to the tree and you touch it, just comes out very easily. When it is green, you have to twist it, and then pull it. Still, it won't come. Correct, na? So, that means the kacha devotee. Pakka devotee means detachment comes very easily. More ripe devotee. So, we become more ripe by studying books very nicely. Therefore, this is the way we should study Prabhupada book. Inspect it from all angles, scrutinizingly study it. Next time when I come, I can devote time for this. How to contemplate when we read Prabhupada books? How to reflect and how to come up with a plan of action to apply in our life. If Radheshyam Prabhu, remind me next time, one talk we can have on that. That will take an hour or so to talk, but it's very valuable. Then our reading would be very fruitful. Then the next one, hearing. Prabhu, you can show that? Last one, yeah. So, in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Kaviraj Goswami is comparing hearing to eating and drinking. Like on Ekadashi day, when you don't eat grains, you feel weak. Correct, no? On other days, when you eat grains, you feel stronger. In the same manner, he says that when we hear lectures of our spiritual master and great souls, when we hear, that is like eating grains. And Prabhupada says to hear and explain them is more important than just reading, he says. Actually, how you can assimilate the philosophy, you have to hear and explain. The word explain is important. Akhyatani apyaditani, he says in the Bhagavatam. Akhyatani aditani means you should hear them and explain to somebody. For example, when you hear a lecture, many things come into your ear and they go away from another ear. We forget many times. But if you make some notes, points, and later on sit with the circle of friends and recollect the points, that's called mananam. So, shravanam, then mananam means recollecting by repeating those points. And nididhyasan means seeing the world through that knowledge. Then you get realization. Okay? So, we can have bookish knowledge, which is called knowledge. Wisdom means hearing from great souls. And realization means when you apply that knowledge and wisdom in your life, then you get realization. When you combine all the three, knowledge, wisdom, realization, that is called maturity. Then you become a mature devotee. If you want to become a ripe mango or a ripe peru, then we need knowledge from the books, wisdom from hearing great souls, and application in our life leading to realization. Then we become very mature, and then we become calm, cool, collected, and peacefully situated in our mind. Then we can do spiritual life in a focused way. So I'll stop with this. And one very vital point got missed out in my discussion. Maybe 2 minutes I'll take and I'll conclude that. One question was asked that, you know, why did, you know, Supreme Lord allow Bharat to become a deer in the next life? Lord says, Trayate Mahato Bayat in Bhagavad Gita. You know, if a man has done some devotional service, he can never become an animal. Then how did Lord allow him to become animal? So there is one slide I have for that, explaining that. I will show that one slide in 2-3 minutes. Prabhu, I will tell you the slide number. You can directly go to that. This is 47, Prabhu, 47 number. Slide number 47. Yeah, that's the one. See, I have written many points. Although Bharat became a deer, he had remembrance of the past life, correct, no? And he also, he was born in a place called Kalanjara Mountains, but as soon as he was born, he cried. He said, alas, I had a human body before, I wasted it, so now I got the body of a deer now. So he left Kalanjara Mountain and came to Pulahashrama. And in Pulahashrama, he was hiding behind the bushes, and he was associating with saintly persons. Because there the sages were all speaking Krishna Katha and he heard it very attentively. And also all the other deers were eating green grass, but he was eating only dry grass, which means he was doing austerity also. And he associated with saintly people. And also he experienced great intense spiritual emotions. He actually cried tears of repentance. Alas, what a fool I was. Such a golden opportunity of human life I wasted like that. And then in the next life also attained a Jadabharat's body of a pure devotee, he attained also. And although he was in a deer's body, he was fully knowledgeable of the scriptures. Therefore, don't think he's an ordinary deer. Although he was in a deer's body, Prabhupada says, this is only Lord's small token punishment Lord gave him to sort of remind him and shake him and wake him up. For that, he gave him deer's body for a short time. But very quickly, he went back to Godhead. So one should not think that he became a deer. It's not important what body you possess, but what is your consciousness? That is most important. He had the consciousness of a pure devotee, even in the body of a deer. So it's Lord's arrangement for him to repent. Just like Nalakur Manigri were given the body of trees, so my spiritual master was speaking in one lecture, he was joking, he was telling, Nalakur Manigri were inside the body of trees, and they were lamenting, what fools we were. We got a devata body and we were, you know, meddling with women in the water, drinking liquor and all that, they were thinking. And then they were seeing that devakanyas or devis from the heavenly planets, they were walking past them, past the trees. They would walk, they would not even look at them because they were in trees' body, you know. So who is going to look at the tree? But earlier when they had a handsome body, they were all, there were also apsaras who were attracted to them. So now Nalakur Manigiri have understood that now we are trapped in a tree's body, we are very foolish. That helped them to repent. So anybody who has a heart of repentance and penance, they are rightly situated. We should repent for our bad past and we should be willing to do penances to purify our heart. When we do this, Prabhupada writes, you put in Bhagavatam purports, repentance and penance, you will get one purport. Prabhupada writes about it. Repentance and penance. So we should repent for the past and perform penance now for a brighter future. That's what one should do. So I'll stop with this. Many, many things we discussed. Now I understood when I made the PPT now, it'll take probably one sitting for each of the themes. Totally we have 8 sessions we have in this. We could do probably 2 or 3 we did yesterday and today. So I thank you all for your rapt attention and great enthusiasm in coming in large numbers, filling up the temple hall and taking part. I can very confidently say that you all are very sincere about your spiritual life. And the pastime of Bharat Maharaj and this kind of pastimes exists in the Srimad Bhagavatam on one hand to inspire us to become more sincere and serious in spiritual life, at the same time to warn us to be very cautious of the nature of the material world. So thank you very much. I can take one question till another. We have 4-5 minutes. We have for 8:45. Can take one question. Anybody? I especially want to thank Radheshyam Prabhu for making all arrangements for my he and Prashant Prabhu also. Paramanand Prabhu. Yeah. Actually, Radheshyam Prabhu and Paramanand Prabhu have been writing nice to me and helped me coordinate the travel as well as to stay here. And today our temple vice presidents, they took me around to show all the different parts of the temple and the different things that are going on. It was so thrilling. I have learned many things while being there, which I can go and play back. And Haribhatta Maharaj, afternoon during lunch, he gave more than a couple of hours sharing so many amazing realizations. I feel very blessed to be here. And I feel very much at home in this place because there is a lot of investment from the top leaders on the community here. I am very feeling myself the opportunity to be here. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhu, thank you for the nice session. So one thing that practically will help me especially is when we are dealing with so many different devotees in the community, you know, we are ourselves not pure and we are also dealing with different, different type of... So how not to become distracted, because we sometimes think that this is my family, right? Like this is my spiritual family. But when there are some frictions or misunderstandings or whatever, then that puts the maximum...
One devotee asked as well as Bhakti Brihad Bhagavat Maharaj. He said, Maharaj, in this corner if there is politics, I am not inspired to come to temple, he was telling. Then Maharaj asked him, he said, answer me questions, he said, in the temple, are the deities giving darshan? Yes. He said, yes. Is the Mangala Arati happening? Yes. What about Tulsi Arati, Narasimha Arati and Bhagavatam class? Yes, Maharaj, that will happen. Are the Prabhupada books being sold? Yes. Yes, Maharaj. The prasadam being served? Yes. Yes, Maharaj. Are the devotees standing and dancing in the temple hall? It's going on? Yes, that's happening. Then Maharaj said, so many things are happening, why don't you see that? And then maybe some devotee is creating politics in corner and you are putting focus only on that. He said, that is an insignificant thing. See the brighter side, see the sunny side of the temple. 99% things are good. Maybe 1% there are some problems. Krishna says in the 18th chapter, when you lit up fire, there is also smoke. Smoke is not what you want, but smoke is inevitable when you lit up fire. So don't look at the smoke. Look at the fire, because fire is going to help you cook the sabji. But if somebody is saying, hey, smoke is coming, so I will put out the fire, then it is useless. So as long as the fire is cooking the sabji, we should be happy. Little smoke we have to tolerate. Similarly, Prabhupada said, when you want to milk a cow, the cow will give kicks. But if you become angry with the cow and sell off the cow, there's no milk. Correct, no? So you tolerate the kicks, then you can get milk. Tolerate the smoke, you can get the fire to cook. Similarly, tolerate little politics here and there, then you can become a nice devotee in ISKCON also. Because it's material world, you know, all living beings are not like Vaikuntha Vasis. We want everybody to be pure devotee, and that is impractical in the material world. Prabhupada said, we are recruiting people from the general mass of crowd of people. So people come with so many mental motivations and, you know, mental scripts people come with. So we have to overlook it, because, so Gauranga Prabhu once, when he came to Pune, he was giving a class, one very funny example he gave. He said that, say you go to a hospital, for example, where they have very nice, beautiful, separate ward they give you, separate room they give you for, and they have a very nice cot, very nice cushion, soft bed, and there are nurses to attend to you, and there is doctor to attend to you. And time-time food is also coming. Only thing is they give you injection with poison, for example. You want to be in that hospital. Or there's another hospital where they put you in a cot, it has got only three legs. Fourth one is not there. It keeps on totally going like this. And also you have to really shout and yell for nurse to come, for the food to come on time, they bring it late. And the room is very sandy, dusty, it is not cleaned up. And you are very unhappy. But the only thing is that that hospital is famous for giving the purest medicines and curing the people. So he asked, which one would you like to go? So everybody chose the second one. And he said, second one is ISKCON, he said. He said, why? He said that, what he said in ISKCON, there may be little mismanagement may be there, little politics may be there, little, you know, quarrels may be there. But the medicine is, how many of you are confident the medicine is perfect medicine? That we should be happy with. Because medicine is directly coming from Prabhupada's books. Prabhupada, everybody has love for Prabhupada and faith in Prabhupada also. So between Prabhupada and us, there are multiple, very various, small, different level devotees are involved, who are still, they are the kacha mango becoming pakka mango gradually. So we are very unhappy with the kacha mango now. But eventually it will become pakka, because it's connected to the tree. We have to remain connected and go on. On the other hand, other organizations are very well behaved, they are very decent, they teach them how to do PR and everything. Only thing is, they don't give you Krishna. They give you all mundane things, isn't it? So therefore, we should see the brighter side. I have a seminar on learning to see good in others and how to overcome fault-finding. In that we do many skits also we do, how to overcome this kind of situation. At the same time, that will also help in rectifying the problems also. One thing is that is a slate workshop, it takes 6 hours. I don't know how to do that. But it is available in the... Okay, I will tell you a very easy to access website, www.slate.radheshyamdas.com. You can put slate, S-L-A-T-E, my name, and then .com you put, you will get. Actually, recently I made very easy to approach links like this for anybody to access. There this is put up. The video is also there, and notes is also available. What do you call it? The booklet also is available. You can go through it your own later. So yeah, then somewhere you can have some very good learning. Yeah. All right, provide, can put here.
Radheshyam Prabhu, today is the birthday of Krishna
Kesava
Prabhu. Can you please give your...
Oh, where is Krishna
Kesava
Prabhu?
He's hiding behind
the... Everybody's come to... And he has come all the way from Parvel.
What plan?
All of you chant for Mahamantra Prabhu, salute Radha Nilamada with Blasam and his family to flourish in the Krishna consciousness. Haribo!
Haribo!
Hare Krishna.
you have some recent Discover Yourself course graduates, if you are around here, please come here. So this is our introductory course to spiritual life. And these students, they have just completed this course and have learned a lot. So we are celebrating this by giving a small gift packet and submitted. Still in the hands of this guest Radheshyam Prabhu, who actually spread the glory of this Discover Yourself course all over the world. His PowerPoint presentations are considered the best in the entire world of what it is called. So
Mara Prabhu, please come.
Oh, Krishna.
Jai Shri Mataji. Kalyan Ki Prabhu. Are you here? Kalyan Ki Prabhu. Srinivas Chilli. Harma Chilli. Tarun Gupta. Lakshika Garg. Lakshika Garg Mataji. Hema, what was it? Others will put it over. Lalit Kumar. Lalit Kumar. Next one, brother, next one. M. Srikant. What is your name, bro?
Sorry?
Vivek. Vivek. Blank now. Yeah, Vivek Prabhu. You know, blank.
What is your name? Sudharani. Your name?
Yes, Sudharani Mataji. And Soumya Mataji.
Anybody wants to share their experience of, you know, just for a minute, what you have learned in this course? Yeah, you want to share?
Yeah. Hare Krishna. So, I'm not a great book reader or anything, but after joining the Discover Yourself class, we used Prabhu's PowerPoint, and the audios, they were very effective, and we don't have to go through the books and sit for a long time and read and grasp all the knowledges, and just by listening the audio itself, it was very effective, and we were able to grasp all the knowledges that we want to get, and it was a very good kickstart to start our spiritual experience. So in that way, all our team members, we benefited a lot. And we thanks, we convey our sincere thanks to Sadhiram Prabhu, Radheshyam Prabhu, and Gaurangchandra Prabhu, and all the devotees who helped us to progress in that spiritual path. Thanks, Prabhu. Thanks.
So, This batch was by Gauranga Chandra Prabhu, who just completed. So this is only a beginning. Discover Yourself is only a beginning. Next is you learn, you can join a Bhagavad Gita batch. We have a new batch recently started in Samamish. So I encourage all of you to join the batch. So we'll give you the details. So please join. So thank you for joining us. So we express our gratitude and much thanks to His Grace Radheshyam Prabhu for giving us his wonderful association. It was pretty hectic. Almost every minute was utilized, every second actually. He didn't have any personal time, just back to back, total schedule was packed. So we are extremely grateful for giving such wonderful practical tips. And we request him to come more often and give us more practical guidance. He has done wonders in India, and he's started doing now in West. So we see more wonders in the near time. Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Prabhu. So let's say Hari Bol to Prabhuji three times. Hare Krishna. Hari Bol.